Let's continue our discussion of the main synovial joints with the hip joint. The hip joint is another example of a ball and socket joint. So if we recall, the other main one is the shoulder joint. But let's think about the osteology behind these two joints. When you're talking the hip joint, you have that very bulbous head of the femur fitting into the fairly deep acetabulum as compared to the head of the humerus and the shallow glenoid fossa of the scapula. So with the better articulation in the hip joint, you know that there's a bit more stability within this joint, but still quite a bit of mobility. So let's talk about the types of motions that can occur here. All right, so let's begin with flexion and extension. And similar to most of the other movements and other joints, flexion for the hip joint, you're going to be moving anteriorly, and extension back into anatomical position. Now, as you can see here, it will extend quite a ways back in terms of hyperextension, so past anatomical position. Now, I want you to think about, when you're talking about flexion, how small the range of motion is here as compared to if, say, why don't you try flexing your knee and then extending the thigh. There's quite a bit more range of motion there. So that's one of those cases where another joint and what's going on at that particular joint can play a big role in terms of range of motion at another joint. All right, let's do abduction and adduction now. So we are in a coronal or frontal plane. You can see abduction, we're moving away from the midline, and adduction back to midline. And then anytime you have flexion extension, abduction and adduction, you have circumduction. Now, if you think about the comparison here, the circumduction that can occur at the shoulder is quite a bit more than what you have here at the hip joint. And anytime you have a ball and socket joint, you have this additional movement in a different axis, and that's medial and lateral rotation. Now you can see here in the model here, that she is flexing her knee, and you can really better visualize this action with the flexion of the knee. Lateral rotation, think of the femoral head moving laterally. So all the same motions that you have occurring at the shoulder joint also occurs at the hip joint, just not with as much range of motion. So a lot more stability here in the hip joint, and that makes sense if you think about what's going on here in terms of being able to grasp things, things like that, as compared to the hip, where you need it to be more stable in order to allow for you to be able to stand upright, in order to locomote. So, with the better fit of the bone, you also have some of the strongest ligaments of the body, and in some textbooks you actually see these referred to as the strongest ligaments of the body. So the main one that I want you to remember is your iliofemoral ligament, and the name actually makes sense here. So let's think about ilio, what bone do you think this comes from? This is going to attach to the ilium, all right? So you can see in this particular visual here, the ilium, all the way to the femur. So you can see here is the femur. So this is a fairly expansive ligament and really plays a big role in not allowing for that femur or the hip joint to hyperextend too far. So we were talking about how there's quite a bit more of range of motion as you go past extension or past anatomical position, but this really plays as a check in terms of that. Now there's two other ligaments also in this area that are of importance. You have your pubofemoral and your ischiofemoral, so attaching to the pubis as well as the ischium, and they play a similar role in terms of checking the hip joint, keeping it in terms of only allowing a certain range of motion. Now, one other thing that I want to make sure that you understand, and this is going to come up and has come up over and over again in terms of the joints, is that we talk a lot about ligaments, but it's really important to consider the muscles that are playing a role in terms of stabilization. So if you think about, without us having really discussed too much in terms of the muscles, which particular ones are going to be in this area? And if you think posteriorly, you have your gluteus muscles. So not only the gluteus maximus, which is the largest, but the gluteus medius and the gluteus minimus, as well as lateral rotators of the hip, which are going to be deep to all the gluteal muscles, deep and inferior. So those play an important role in terms of stabilizing the joint allowing for us to be able to locomote in an efficient way.